Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for coming. This is a special session on the organization of the Research Excellence Framework. My name is Sergey. I study corruption in academic market, so REF seems to be a reasonable topic for me. This session brings together people of different backgrounds, different specialties. So first is Peter Neary, who used to be the chair of the Economics and Econometrics panel in REF 2014. The second speaker would be Gianni De Fraja, who has not only experience in the UK market, but also in the markets all over the world. And the third speaker is Andrew Oswald, who has a lot of opinions about how to organize the REF correctly. We had a fourth speaker who couldn't be with us because of medical problems, so we'll have more time for questions. So there are two ways how you can ask questions. One is there will be two specially trained people with microphones who will come to you and give you a microphone if you want to ask your question out loud. However, I understand that some people have stuff to lose and they are afraid of asking questions out loud and being videotaped while they are doing so. So the session is being videotaped, so control yourself. You can email your question to my email and I will ask without revealing your identity, and hopefully that will create a little bit more lively discussion than otherwise would be possible. If there are no questions, I suggest we start. I assume people already came from their lunch, and the first speaker is Professor Neary, and let's do the thing. Thanks.
No, I think he's ready. Yeah, okay. Lovely. Thank you very much. You're all very far away. I hope people can hear me. So thank you, Sergey, very much for organizing this session. I need to start with a few disclaimers to thank Sergey again for organizing this session, which is not an official Royal Economic Society event. So I'm involved in the Royal Economic Society. I was involved with the with the economic subpanel, and perhaps much more important in my career, I was Nick Stern's first PhD student. None of these bear any relation to to what I'm going to say. So I'm saying what I like and haven't consulted with, nor do I represent anyone. And what is it? Well, Sergey's brief, I hope people are aware of this. The plan for this session, I think, is economists looking at the REF. And we're not really trying to give you details of, you know, dark secrets of what happened in the last REF, or serious predictions about what may happen in the next, but rather trying to both stand back and take an economist's perspective from a distance and the big picture question, and also lean forward and perhaps look at more of the details of different proposals, different configurations for the new REF, and think about exactly how they might work. So I'm going to talk about three things. Sort of, first of all, issues of research evaluation in principle, a few remarks about that. And then I want to talk a little bit about the production function for research. And then I want finally to discuss the question of what are the appropriate units of assessment. So research evaluation in principle, are we for it or against it? Well, we're all for other professions being evaluated one way or another. You wouldn't want to go to a doctor who hadn't passed some tests. You wouldn't want banks to be unregulated completely. So it seems to me that some kind of evaluation seems desirable in principle. Of course, for an economist, stepping back, not thinking about the UK just for a moment, the obvious question to ask is, well, you know, we have markets to do lots of these things, and why don't we use markets rather than planning? The many paradoxes of the REF, the founding paradox, is that great pioneer and champion of free markets, Margaret Thatcher, saw in her wisdom to set up what it could be arguably said to be the most Stalinist, the most centralized form of evaluation that we have. You know, groups of the great and the good who are appointed from one seven-year cycle to the next and so on. So what are the pros and cons of that? Well, when we think about it from an economist's point of view, in the UK, you look at economics in the UK, and the obvious reference point is economics in the US. And the temptation is to say, well, the US manages to work without a ref. What are they missing? And of course, what they have is a very well-functioning market, which evaluates things, which evaluates individuals and evaluates departments in a dispassionate and, let's face it, very efficient way. Why don't we just transform that or transfer that to the UK, or rather just let the market rip? And I think here's where Economics 102 comes in. Economics 101 says the market is better on average, but then you think about it a little more and you have to be careful of the institutional context. And I think there are differences which can be subtle but really play a big role if you compare the US with the UK. One that I think is probably a bit underappreciated is what I like to call a deep market for deans. Deans being the sort of middle managers between departments and the vice chancellor or the university president. I think the US has that. At the very top, deans who are successful in building up the research side of their of their remit, whether it's the whole university or the College of Arts and Sciences or whatever, that enhances their career and they can move between universities and they can of course aspire to become university presidents at a later stage. We have that in the UK to some extent, but not at all on the same scale. Why is a different question. But bringing in, you know, abandoning the ref and having just a market in the absence of that, I think would be worrying. I think in some ways a more deeper thing, which may partly underpin the reason for a deep market for deans, is the dark secret of American universities, I like to think, which is that they typically insulate colleges of arts and sciences from professional schools. Professional schools that, you know, do medicine or law or business or whatever are hived off and allowed to do their own thing, whatever that is, including some research, some really world-class research, really excellent academic research in many, many areas, but the criteria are different, the approach is different, whereas what we think of as research in the sense of contributing to Nobel Prizes, contributing to Shanghai rankings, contributing to real impact in terms of, I would say, societal impact, most of that gets done in colleges of arts and sciences, and that's going to be a theme that we'll see later coming up in the details of the ref. Without that insulation, I think, again, the free market applied in a, you might say, naive, off-the-shelf way simply wouldn't work in a UK context. A better comparison in some ways I like to draw, of course, given my background, is the UK versus Ireland. Ireland has a very good university system, you know, thanks to having been a British colony. Being a colony isn't fun, but if you must be a colony, be a British colony. So we have universities without, I say we, now being a UK resident, in Ireland have universities very well run. Political interference? No. Academic criteria imposed from the top and from the bottom. Some pockets of outstanding excellence. And yet, having worked there for many years, I can see a difference. It's not that there aren't world-class scholars in Irish universities. It's not that academic values are not instilled and are not part of the atmosphere. But there's no evaluation, so there's nothing to stop people, you know, being the kind of super world-class professional researchers who don't actually publish. Okay? And at the end of the day, that's observationally equivalent to people who are actually not world class most of the time. So I do think that, you know, let's face it, the ref, you may not like it, but what does the R stand for? It stands for research. And by privileging research and by putting it on a pinnacle, and by also, as I'll come to in a moment, by proposing how it be evaluated, basically through peer review, I think that's a good starting point for how a proper evaluation mechanism should be implemented. So that's very much background general stuff, but of course the devil's in the details. So how do we measure research? Well, how is research produced? An obvious question is we want to distinguish between inputs and outputs. That's the kind of basics, the basic point with which an economist would start. And what are the outputs? I think we're all agreed research is an output. Got it? Not obviously got it. I've mentioned Ireland. In Ireland, research funding is often taken as an independent measure of an output. In the Treasury statement that preceded and did not eventually completely influence the last REF exercise, it was proposed that research funding be used as one of a number of metrics of research. And that caused outrage, and I think it's fair to say there is justifiable outrage. Research funding is correlated with research quality, but the correlation is not strong and it varies across disciplines. I am inclined to the view, I say this as a research grant, having recently finished a big research grant myself, that the correlation in economics is weak between size of research funds and quality of research is weaker than it is, say, in the natural sciences. And in the humanities, I think research funding is, I won't say random, I don't want to annoy people, but again, it's a very poor measure of research. So the fact that 65% of the grades in the REF goes for research outputs in itself is a very good start. Now, of course, that's not all. Second was research impact, new in 2014, and according to the Stern Review and ongoing consultations that we hear about the Stern Review, the proposal is to leave it basically unchanged in 2021. Actually, not just the questions will be unchanged, but the answers may be unchanged. People will be allowed to resubmit the same research impact statements as they did first time round. That's a detail, I'm not going to go into that. Is this a good thing or a bad thing? I must confess, I'm inclined to the view that actually it's an output. And while it's not research per se, it is there is clearly a lot of concern outside academia about what's all this stuff. What's the point of it all? They can see the point of teaching, but people cannot necessarily see the point of research. And okay, if it wins Nobel Prizes or makes big headlines, but they would like to have a sense that what you might call normal science, the kind of routine research that doesn't in itself necessarily generate headlines, they'd like to get a sense that that is making a contribution to society. And the bottom line is that the fund givers insist on that, and indeed it was the Treasury who insisted on it being imposed in the last REF. It caused a lot of angst. As chair of the sub-panel, I was anxious myself beforehand. Ex post, I'm open to correction on this, and perhaps this is something we can discuss, but I think it's fair to say that in practice it proved relatively uncontroversial for a number of reasons. The main thing is that it was done on a disciplinary basis. So a given university's research impact in economics was compared relative to other universities. Research impact in economics. Comparing economics with medicine would have been disastrous for us, and comparing economics with literature would have been disastrous for them. I think partly because of that, it ended up working out reasonably well, reasonably uncontroversially. I don't stand over, it's not my idea, but as the awful things in the world, if they're lined up, that for me would not be too far from the, too close to the top. What would be close to the top, and here I am exercising my freedom of speech, as it were, I'm not committing anyone, is environment. It's only 15%, but gosh, how silly. I mean, at best, in evaluating research environment, that's an input. And what does it mean? At worst, it's cheap talk. And one of the challenges to the sub-panel was to resist using the information we knew. The dogs in the street know that University A, nobody ever goes into their offices. University B, they treat their junior staff like dirt. University C, etc. But we weren't allowed to use that information because it's all hearsay. It was hearsay, and you would like information that's used to be standardized in some ways. Anyway, we couldn't do that. We had to read the four pages of carefully crafted fiction that were submitted to us. So even if you accept that there's something in this stuff, these four pages, how do you interpret it? Okay, suppose you say, oh God, this is great environment. The environment here is really good. It's actually better than their outputs. Well, that's actually a terrible department, isn't it? They've got these swanky new buildings and they've got a super duper structure with, the head of department and committees and lots of money for postgrads, and junior staff can travel to any conference they want to, and they don't produce any research. That's bad, isn't it? Environment worse than outputs, great. Isn't that a great department? They've lousy 18th century buildings that are falling apart, and they have poor incentives, apparently, but somehow or other, they just knuckle under and actually produce the stuff. So I think that this is just ridiculous. And I like to say this is analogous to awarding Olympic medals for the quality of sports facilities. And I've said this many times, and people laugh at the joke, and then they go on and they say, well, it doesn't matter, it's only 15% or whatever. The fact that it's intellectually bankrupt and has no foundation doesn't seem to have caught on. There was even one main panel chair, of course I can't say whom, who recommended that the proportion should be increased from 15 to 25%. 25% for the quality of their sports facilities. Think of all the medals that that might be achieved on the basis of that. Anyway, that's a rant. A separate issue, which is, let's going back now to research specifically, how do you measure research quality? Well, I want to dump a bit onto what I think of as myths. Maybe there's something to be said for them, and obviously this is something we will want to discuss. One myth, and this is very much specific to economics and comes back to the peculiar features of economics, let's face it. We're journal-based, like the natural sciences, but we have publication lags that are longer than books in the humanities. Certainly at the top journals and increasingly at other journals as well. So one, I do think it's a myth. We can tell the quality of a paper by where it appeared. And myth number two is that metrics, which would in this case include number of top journal articles published or whatever, are fairer, are more objective than experts. Well, I think the key problem with both of these myths is that they make a fundamental error, which is a failure to distinguish between a distribution and a draw. Okay, so the average paper in the Quarterly Journal of Economics, is it better or worse than the average paper in Oxford Bulletin of Economics and Statistics? And you don't need a PhD in economics to answer the question. Of course it is. But that's averages, right? And then distributions are distributions. Just for fun, I did those distributions, and they overlap. They don't actually overlap very much. I think Andrew has drawn attention to a really great paper, much cited in Oxford Bulletin 2009. This is in the previous ref window. It gets over 600 citations. That's a big number. This is web of, this isn't Google. I haven't looked actually in Google Scholar. I'm sure it gets well over 1, possibly 2,000 citations. So that's a cool paper. But you look at the other papers in that ref window in that journal, and you know things start to go down. The second one gets 129, still impressive, 126 and so on, but down to 52 at number 7. The H index, as you know, the number of papers, 20 papers got 20 or more citations, okay? And that's out of 243. The median was 4. 13 papers got 0 citations. Now, this isn't a critique of the Oxford Bulletin. It's just an attempt, without actually doing the hard work of drawing the whole distribution. I didn't have time for that. This took me 10 minutes. It's just getting a feel for the distribution. And we can compare it with the QJE distribution in the same period. Dominated at the top, so this isn't... So the QJE doesn't stochastically dominate because 545 is less than 607, but a lot less. And after that, everything is dominant. I don't need to, I mean, repeating the obvious here. The H-index, 71 papers got over 71 citations, with the total number very comparable, slightly more, the median 38, 37 or so. 2 papers got 0 citations, etc. Bottom line, JP is very similar. Bottom line then is that these distributions, one doesn't stochastically dominate the other, okay, but it comes very close to doing so. So on average, a QJE paper is better than an OBS paper, fact. Right? In practice, there are good papers in every journal, including this one, and that should be taken into account. And who's going to take it into account? Well, you could say, of course, that's okay, no problem, because as I've shown, I'm looking at citations here. But that isn't enough, actually, because, of course, citations are late. That was, remember, a citation that we citation indices that we have now for the last ref window. For the next ref window, they will at best have citations as of 2021. Okay, so citations are late, and there's a real problem about applying them in context. They're also manipulable. If it was well known that the ref was actually going to be based exclusively on citations, a little computer, you know, saving all the money that's paid out for the expenses of academics to sit on these subpanels, that little computer would actually change behavior, and people would start, you know, citation cabals and so on. They're also field specific. You compare, you know, I'm lucky, I work in international trade where people tend to cite a lot. Economic theory, people don't cite quite so much. And there are differences across subfields, not to mention, of course, between disciplines. So I think on both these counts, then, I would be inclined to argue that we need to think about a distribution versus a draw, and we need humans to do that. Okay. The bottom line is that citations can inform experts, but not replace them. Peer review is not a great system, but I can't think of a better one. Okay. And the idea of computerized review is really an alarming prospect and one to be resisted. And to be fair, the authorities have resisted it, or at least it has not been imposed, although it has been suggested. So how am I doing? 2 more minutes, I think. Yeah. And so the last thing I want to talk about is units of assessment. And here the question is, who or what do you want to assess? And you've got quite a choice. You could think of assessing universities, disciplines, economics, departments, economics and econometrics, or individuals. And of course, there's an overlapping process to a considerable extent. One thing about universities, actually the money goes to universities. We all know stories, the economics head who goes to the university president says, look, we got a 4-star, isn't this great? We want more money now. And the university president says, well, it's great, of course, congratulations, you got a 4-star, but you are good already, so you don't need more money. I'm going to give extra money to Department X, which got a 1-star. So the universities get the money, economics departments, the individual departments get prestige and so on, but not that. At the end of the day, we don't really want to evaluate universities as a whole because we do worry about granularity. It's one thing to say that, you know, a particular university is the best in the world or the best in Europe, or according to the London Times, the best in the world based in Britain. I wonder what the Singapore Times says or what the New York Times says. But anyway, we are interested in the granularity, going down to the level of individual departments. On the other hand, there is an increasing returns effect. And here's one tiny little detail, which I think is a great idea, which is a proposal in the Stern Review to have environment evaluated at an upper level, at a university level, rather than at a departmental level. I dumped on environment earlier, but conditional on actually giving points for it, it seems to make sense to give those points at the university level, rather than to think about individual departments being singled out as having good or bad environments, given that the context and the funding, especially funding context, but also the governance and so on context, is set at university level. So now, what about disciplines versus departments? Well, this is a big issue for economics because there are huge incentives to decouple them. Issue, of course, that has arisen for economics is that many economists are not now submitted to the economic subpanel. And the economic subpanel has not reached sub-critical size, but it's pretty close. I think that's very alarming. I think it's a very bad thing. And it's not unusual to economics. You can see it in other disciplines. Maybe I won't talk about the disciplines to which departments that don't get high scores in their own original discipline flee, but I will mention sociology, psychology, and medicine, some parts of medicine, as other disciplines where you get the same kind of hollowing out. That is to say, the bottom tail of the distribution reassigning themselves or reassigning large numbers of their staff to a different discipline, in other words, a different subpanel for ref purposes, in the hope, and indeed, typically, within the sure knowledge that they'll do better when evaluated according to different criteria. I think that's a great pity. Stern Report had a brilliant way of combating it. There are many ways you could combat it. You've heard of research-led teaching. Remember, we all think that's a great idea. Well, why not insist that researchers are evaluated according to the discipline that they're supposed to be teaching? Very simple. And the data's there to do it. Well, there would be knock-on effects. There would be the danger of lots of people currently with research contracts being reassigned to teaching-only contracts. There would be knock-on effects. But the fact remains, it would be the right way to do things. And guess what? The universities have said, no, 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 that is not going to happen, apparently. That's the word on the street. The rumours I hear suggest that the decoupling of disciplines and departments is going to continue. So there will be nothing to stop people taking university heads assigning economists to any field they like, subject to it being not too totally implausible. So that leaves individuals, and this is my last point, I have one more slide. The three issues that the Stern report brought up, should everyone be submitted? Should we have decoupling in a different sense, decoupling of individuals from outputs? And finally, should outputs be portable? So let me briefly comment on those. These are my personal views. Should it be mandatory to submit everyone? I think in principle, yes, with a proviso in proportion to their time in the department. If they're 50% in a different UK university, they get 50%. If they're 50% in a different university not in the UK, they get 100%. That's a ridiculous thing. That's absolutely crazy. It makes no sense. And it kind of undermines the credibility of the whole process. It would be very simple to do something about that, but nothing has been done. But anyway, in principle, the bigger picture, yes, it would be a good idea to submit everyone. But in practice, we know that universities will adjust. This is sometimes called gaming, as if people didn't game. We're economists. We teach first years about gaming, about maximizing subject to constraints. That's what agents do all the time. And universities will do it. There would be new contracts, research only or teaching only contracts or whatever. There would be new divisions of the academics grouped in different ways, as I've said already, and so on. So I worry a bit about requiring everyone to be submitted. I think it's, on balance, probably the right way to go, but I'm open to correction, and the devil would be in the detail there. Individuals and outputs decoupled, it does risk accentuating the superstar culture. Here the issue is, can you submit individuals who themselves do not have any papers in order to boost your numbers? But then you've got a few superstars an average of two and four, possibly even six papers could be submitted. All of this is under review at the moment in discussions about the form of the next ref, but I do worry a bit that it risks going for this superstar culture. And that the same issue is true for outputs. Should they be portable or not? This is about rents. Who gets the rents? And in economics, we know what the rents are. Getting back to my earlier point, not for any very for papers one by one, but for papers on average, you can predict the score. And high score means that that department division will do well, so there are rents. So who gets the rents? Well, in 2014, in principle, the rents were assigned to individuals. I don't mean every individual availed of that, but we did see a lot of movement in the 6 months or 12 months before the ref census date. And so you got an accentuation of the superstar culture, by which I mean an extreme increasing divergence in salaries, in treatment, in types of contracts, and so on. I think that's unhealthy, and the fact that it all happens at the last minute is really, really very ridiculous and a highly inefficient system. The alternative, zero portability, would mean, which is proposed in the Stern review, would allow universities to retain the rents. It would make it harder to forecast research submissions, because this means you've got to think ahead, try to anticipate an individual's research output over the course of the ref. Individuals themselves can't do that. Again, the real problem with economics, the payoff to top journalists is enormous, and yet it comes with a very long lag. So it would be very hard to do that. And it would also stop rich universities scooping the pot at the last moment. And again, I'm being indiscreet here, given that I'm being recorded, so let me attribute to an unknown source the rumour going around, which is that the Russell Group pushed for this lack of portability, but are now getting cold feet. And the rumour is that they anticipate that actually they're the ones with the money and they're the ones who would actually benefit from being able to bid superstars away from other universities at the very last minute. Up in the air. To be perfectly honest, what can we say as economists? Well, we have the Coase theorem, which says that formal rent assignments affect distribution, of course, but not efficiency. You get the same outcome. But the Coase theorem doesn't apply in a sequential game. You're allocating rights ex ante before other players have moved. So I honestly think, without sitting down and working really hard to construct a model, which I haven't done, it's very hard to predict the outcome of this. And that, to me, has one very simple implication. It's a very big change to make with less than 4 years before the deadline. And so I think I would be against that. I'm finished. I guess my bottom line is, the ref is, I think, a really terrible way of evaluating research. Happy to be quoted on that, but it's much better than all the alternative ways. I don't want to say boys will be boys anymore. Agents will be agents. We keep getting this line. There's going to be gaming. The system is going to be gamed. Of course the system's going to be gamed. What you want is a system which, after it has been, which you try and design such that even though it's gamed, it still yields some kind of satisfactory outcome. And I think many of the proposals in the Stern report are going in that direction with qualifications I've mentioned. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, on the Churchillian note that Peter ended his talk, I have to say we haven't exchanged notes, and there will be some overlap, but fortunately not so much, and there are things that we agree most and a couple that we don't, but that's fine. I presented yesterday a paper written with two co-authors on the theme. And these are some of the kind of media highlights of that paper. So what we did, we took data from salary data for professors, full professors only in the UK, and the outcome of the last research assessment exercise. I must premise that had nothing to do with the research. I wasn't involved in any way with the exercise. So it's all public data available to anyone who has a web connection. And it turns out that departments that pay on average their professors more obtain better results in the REF. This is across all disciplines, all 36 units of assessment. The association, this is correlation, obviously we have no causality, although I might say something about it later. The association, the correlation, the positive correlation is weakest in the Russell Group University. Why is that? Probably they all pay more or there's less competition, but there might be more attempt to hire a big superstar in university that are not as established as the Russell Group. And the other thing that Peter was also referring to is the superstar culture, universities that have more unequal salary structure, a higher Gini coefficient, also perform better in the research assessment exercise. So take away these points from these slides, and let's concentrate on that. Now, there could be two explanations for this. One is that if a resource has more money, they can just buy the best players, okay? So that's a Manchester United model. And that's what the REF, the attempt to reduce portability and all that, the hunting for superstars. But there's another model which may or may not apply. I'll call it, I come from Italy, I don't want to insult anyone from other parts of, some different parts of Italy where I come from. But in some countries, academics work in the town where they are born. They just don't move city. They just go to university in their own hometown, they become professor there and they stay there. And it so happens that the draw is such that some locations have better researchers, better people, more honest, more harder working and so on. And so it's completely randomly that some university will do better. And if then researchers are paid more because they are better, then you get the similar association. This is the direction of causality. Is it high pay that causes performance or high performance that causes high pay? We can kind of try to tease out the fact by notice the difference between impact and output. Okay? For those of you who understand the REF, output can be bought. An impact cannot be bought. Okay, so if you are a vice chancellor about to hire a professor. You've got two candidates, just as the deadline for the ref approaches. One candidate has got fantastic output, and the other has got output which is mediocre but has big impact. Which of these two candidates do you hire? You ought to hire the one that has better output, because that will influence your ref return, whereas the impact will not, because it simply cannot be included in your submission. And the fact, it turns out, that the coefficient for output is stronger than the coefficient for impact, which is at the limit of significance. So from that, we infer that universities did try to buy better professors. Okay, so it seems that in the UK, the Manchester United model is the better one. Here comes the Stirner view. I'm going to say something about it, try to approach it as a theoretical economist. So the Stirner view makes some sensible recommendation. Peter was citing the environment one, for example, and some others about the impact and so on. And some recommendations that are easy to circumvent. The one about all staff to be returned to the ref, and then is one. The average the number of papers per submission and the non-portability of output are either harmful or will have unintended effects, or possibly both. And then there are some recommendations that are simply missing. And in my opinion, two of them are the measuring the effect of metric-based measurements, and importantly, the comparability of across disciplines, which I think is completely missing, but potentially very important. So recommendation number one in the Stern review is that all research active staff should be submitted to the ref. As Peter said, this is very easy to circumvent. There will be people that are given a teaching-only contract. And one university I'm aware of, in past exercises, where the proportion of staff you submitted mattered, because there was a letter, for those of you of my age, will remember the letter, 5A, 5B, 5C, 4A, etc. A was the proportion of staff that was submitted. So if you had a 5A, it means everybody was doing research. If you had a 5C, only a small proportion of people were doing research. So how did at least one university operate? Well, they had in a department, they had a group of people that were not performing very well. So they were submitted to the separate unit, all included in this unit. And then the unit itself was not submitted. So, of course, there was no evaluation, but that means that the rest of the department got the full 5A. So it's what Peter Kane calls gaming, which is rational behavior in front of constraints and objectives. So I entirely agree with that. So let's go to the more kind of eye-catching recommendation. Average the number of papers. So that's the wording in the Stern review, which is a quotation. And in particular, there's a suggested range, I don't know how much they're talking still about, that people can submit up to 6 papers. And if somebody has no papers, then that's fine. I'm talking about papers because in economics, it will be papers by and large. Okay, so what's the consequence? Well, first of all, we'll certainly increase inequality, okay? Imagine if some of you here, at some point during the, depending on the next recommendation, has 6 papers conditionally accepted. Okay, they're not accepted because, you have to cite such and such, you have to change that, the proof of that secondary lemma, etc. But essentially, you know they'll get in. Well, you can go to any vice chancellor and say, look, 6 papers in top journal, how much are you going to give me? You have a lovely bidding war, and while you sit on the papers, because if you delay by 2 months, 3 months, it doesn't really matter, because the time lag of publication is so long that no editor at the top journal will say, oh, we must submit next week. So you do that negotiation, you've got immense value. A perfectly rational vice chancellor will give you quite a lot of money because you're worth 3 full staff. So that will necessarily increase the inequality. So the intended aim of reducing the superstar culture is just completely not going to work. There's another cost, which I think is very important. At the moment, one of the things that Stern, the review says, is bad having this, people being not being submitted, is that it's bad for morale. Because if you're not submitted, then you feel bad about your job and you feel not valued, etc. At the moment, there are two groups of people, those submitted that are fine and those not submitted that are, have kind of. But when you can submit from 0 to 6 papers, everybody will feel bad except those that have 6 papers. Because if you have 5, then you think, well, why, you know, I've got 6 papers. Why is my 6th paper not being taken in the paper by so-and-so has? Okay? So it's going to be really, really, everybody's going to be upset except the people who have 6 papers. And immense cost for institutions. I mean, I would not want to be head of department in such a situation because at the moment you have a marginal decision to take. Shall I put John Smith in or not? Okay, it's a difficult decision, he's got to take it. But how do you base it? On the papers that he or she has. He is, John Smith is a he. But once you have 200 papers and you have to choose 100, now that's going to be a very tough decision because, oh, so-and-so is going to be offended because he is very proud of his Oxford Bulletin of Economics and Statistics paper because he thinks he's going to get lots of... So it's going to be a nightmare for heads of school. So luckily I've done it, so I'm not going to do it again. Portability, I've built a very the skeleton of a model, which I'm going to give you. So that's a quote from the Stern review, unhelpful driver of asymmetric salary inflation. so let's build, what would be the elements of a model? Any production function of any type will have capital, labs, etc., labor. So investment of the university. So at some point, the Stern review says, oh, the university makes investments and then they lose it because academics leave. That's true, labs cost money. And labor, and then academics also exert effort because they spend time working rather than playing golf or doing their roses in their garden. But what are the differences between these inputs? Elasticity of supply is different, okay? Labs are competitively supplied. You can just buy them. The knowledge is there. the effort has different importance in the two, okay? So a lab has got specification that is easy to evaluate and so on. And we're going to listen to Oliver Hart tomorrow, and the contractability of investment is very different, okay? If I'm a big boss, a big professor coming from the States, I say, I want this lab here specified in this way, and I can write it down the instruction, but specifying how much effort people should do on their job is very difficult. So different contractability of investment, and that's going to have, so this rule, if implemented, the non-portability, will either shift the negotiation date, so instead of negotiating on the 31st of October 2021, the negotiation date will be any time, because look, I've got three conditional accepts. Let's talk about my promotion. Otherwise, I go to somewhere else. So let's talk about a new job, etc. Or, possibly worse, given the intention of the ref, reduce academic effort. Why? Well, let's think about the timeline. As Peter said, this is not a simultaneous game, so the Coase theorem doesn't quite apply. So I think it's how we would analyze it. This is time. This is time. The ref date, the ref census date is here. At the beginning of the ref period, what happens? The university builds a lab, and they make the hiring decision, etc. And the researcher works hard in order to reap benefit in the market prior to the census date. So in the current system, that's what you have. So the successful researcher benefits, and the university obtains ref funding plus reputation, which is good. And now suppose you just don't have portability, then the researcher reaps no benefit. The unhealthy, what was called salary inflation, doesn't happen, and unhealthy salary inflation is my pay. So I don't get the salary increase because I'm productive. The university obtains the ref funding, the reputation, and they also save money. But there's an arrow going the opposite direction, because we, as economists, but as human beings, can predict what will happen in the future. So we'll know that all our output will just not be valued by the university because they have it already. Okay, and in fact, there's a paper by with me with two co-authors that shows that even Italian academics respond to promotion incentives. Okay, so if they think they're going to be promoted, if they're productive, they are more productive. So the prediction you can make is that effort will be less. What's the point of working hard if I'm not going to get a salary increase at the end of the process? So I think there will be less if we had portability, so I'm glad that Peter says that it might not happen, then there would be less productivity of the UK system. And if we still look at international level, the UK academic system is still the best in the world per capita. Okay, what's missing? And I don't know, how am I doing for time? I'm probably okay, hopefully, am I? Yeah, no, that's good, perfect. Comparability between disciplines. Okay, now that's a big deal. Why? One of the results from this paper I cited at the beginning is we estimate this equation where the left-hand side is the ref output in all departments, department I in, discipline I in university type K. And the only thing I want to concentrate, there's sort of covariates here. The thing I want to concentrate is the discipline fixed effect. Okay, so everything else is equal, but the different disciplines. And that's what it looks like. Okay, so this is the fixed effect, that estimated coefficient for all 36 disciplines, taking as reference value the one with the lowest. With the lowest fixed effect, which happens to be economics and econometrics. As you can see, there are three that are not statistically different, but some are much higher. So how does much, what does much mean? So let's take these two subjects, sports science and media studies. So if you have two identical departments, one in economics, one in media studies or sports science, identical meaning they have all the other covariates, including university, everything the same, but the different disciplines, they get about twice the funding. Okay? That, of course, can be due to two reasons. One is that the quality of the research is lower, and that the other is that the assessment is stricter in one discipline rather than the other. And obviously, we cannot distinguish with the data we have between the two. But I think comparability between disciplines is very important, because the Italian solution of equalizing the size of the cake across disciplines and using the research assessment exercise only to divide the cake between different universities is just not a good solution, because you want to encourage departments that are disciplines that are stronger internationally and so on. The Stern Review is silent about this, and I think it's a very important topic that should be studied, and they should be certainly concerned about it. I don't have any views on how to do it, but is something that is crucial to have a system, for a system, robust system. The last thing I want to say is something that Italians, not all Italians, but Italian economists have done, and have done quite cleverly. The Stern Review does not, and that's possibly a point where Peter and I might have a slight difference in view, but I don't think it's going to be very strong. Let's imagine that we had done a metric-based evaluation. What does metric-based evaluation? Based on journal lists with some adjustment for other criteria. That would be a lot cheaper. There would be just one computer that does it instead of the many hours that I'm sure Peter has spent reading a lot of papers, and his colleague have too. But you can test, you can take a sample, the Italian economist, and I just want to put the name because you might know them and they are good, good people. They proposed that, and it was accepted, that a percentage of the papers in the Italian evaluation exercise, of which I don't know if I said I was a member of the panel, were evaluated with both criteria. And then the correspondence, the correlation between the two evaluations was measured, and it was very high. So for a single paper, I entirely fully agree with people that taking a single draw of a distribution is not going to be informative. But we're not looking at draws, we're looking at distribution of output across departments. So it might be that the Department of Naples, they've got their paper in the Giornale degli Economisti, which is excellent, but evaluated badly because it's not in a good journal. But across distribution, you probably, the errors kind of cancel out. So having the exercise, see how much, how far would we have been from the actual result had we used something different? That's something that could have been proposed by, that would be cheap to do, not free, but could have been proposed by the Stern Review, but wasn't. I think that's it. So I say Italians have proposed to compare peer review with mechanical assessment of based on journal lists. And on this, I stop. Thank you.
Just at the start, Peter Neary said that he doesn't like to use a stick mic because it makes him feel like a pop star. I'm afraid I've always liked stick mics. I think my colleagues have said a number of interesting and sensible things, and very largely I agree with nearly all of Peter's points. I was asked to reflect on what we might think of as general issues in research assessment exercises in the REF itself and so on. So I would like to think of my remarks as in principle being more timeless, you might say. Clearly, this is a very interesting and important area. It goes way beyond economics, way beyond Britain, and presumably will be with universities for some centuries to come. Issue number one that's on my mind is that it really is, when you look at the history of science, including economics, it really is exceptionally hard to tell what will go on to be very important work. I worry about this all the time as a referee. I hope everybody does. I feel the responsibility of blocking some papers and accepting others, and one can only do one's best. Even the most brilliant assessors make terrible mistakes, no doubt including Andrew Oswald, I'm afraid, ladies and gentlemen. And for those here who don't know this bit of the history of science, this one especially is worth considering. It's one of my favorites to teach to students. In 1950, in the BMJ, the British Medical Journal, the seminal paper on smoking and cancer was published by Richard Doll, then a very young man, and a man called Austin Hill. And Ronald A. Fisher, R.A. Fisher, then the world's most famous statistician, was bitterly opposed to the paper, thought that Doll had a spurious correlation between smoking and cancer, did his best to ridicule that whole line of research, and went to his grave. Fisher went to his grave, if you read the history, convinced it was perfectly safe to smoke. This is everybody's problem. We all have tremendous difficulty. We're in the fog of research. That's how I think about it. Just the nature of our business, a very exciting business to be in, the nature of our business is we can't be sure that this paper is really good or important, or our paper is really good or important. Hindsight is the most valuable thing, and I'll come back to that in talking about ref design. Here's another illustration of what we might describe as the ex-ante difficulty, and I don't have an exact solution to this, but it does seem to important to grapple with the concern. I'm going to overlap a bit with Peter Neary here, but we haven't informed each other of our slides and so on. Let's say we take the Economic Journal, for goodness sake, this is the Royal Economic Society, and I thought this is 2017, so let's look at the past decades. I'll use the Web of Science citations. I don't think it's a good idea to have ref panels made up just of computers who count citations and the rest, and perhaps we might return to that. But anyway, this is one source of information that will allow me to make my point. It will be familiar to some of you about the inequality, I suppose, or the unpredictability of intellectual impact in our kind of world. Let's go back 20 years, we'll do 30 and 10 and so on. It won't make any difference, nor will it make any difference which journal we choose. There were 90 articles. If I go back, if I order them through the Web of Science, and then look at the least cited, those with the fewest sites, the bottom 10, that's 1/9, they average less than 2 citations. And that's really after a long, long time. And if we look at the top, of course, exactly consistent with what many people here will know and Peter's point, that the number is just extraordinarily different. The top 10 are on average cited more than 200 times. And that's a really difficult problem for referees and for editors and for members of ref panels, but we do need to bear this in mind, I think. Even with 2.5 serious referees, as it were, with a half input coming from the editors, look at the inequality within a journal. It's quite remarkable. There's the 1987 result, only 54 articles, but it's the same sort of pattern, of course, and it will be the same pattern 50 years from now, no doubt. I haven't got a way for referees to solve the fog of research problem. We just can't do it. And there's the most recent one, again, the same sort of pattern. But somehow or other, ladies and gentlemen, I think if we're designing a REF or REA system way beyond Britain in the next few years, somehow or other, if we could, we should adapt to that and try and optimize against it as a nation or an intellectual community. Loosely, the average good article is just far more influential than the summed value of all 10 of the worst articles, you might say. How are we going to react to that in our design? Here's issue 2, and I don't know about you, but I think about this a lot. I mean, even Nobel Prize winners, you read the, whatever they call them, the stuff, they're barely remembered for more than 2 things. You and I, if we're lucky, we'll get remembered for 1 thing, and we need to face that. This is the closest I could get to a picture of the future Mr. Oswald contemplating his mortality. We need to recognize that, and if I'm allowed a personal note, this can't be said to be based on deep analysis or evidence, I suppose, but if I'm allowed a personal note, it does worry me that through my career, I've seen researchers become more and more concerned with quantity, even though they must know they're only going to be remembered for 1 thing. Issue 3, if we look outside economics, not something necessarily economists do a lot, there's a growing realization of the difference between the impact of an article, however you want to measure it, and the impact factor of the journal. I thought Peter put that very well in a particular way. If you don't know about these kinds of writings, I would recommend them. Heckman pointed out recently that most of the highly cited papers in economics are not published. They're not published in the 5 journals that we hear a particularly large amount about. If you read the writings of the Science, Nature, and PNAS editors, particularly in something called the San Francisco Declaration on Research Assessment, they've recently done their best to make the point that you can't judge an article by the cover of the journal. Something we taught our children, not about articles per se, of course, from when they were very young. Don't judge a book by its cover. Yet you and I know that we hear more and more about the covers, despite everyone presumably knowing the difference. The other sciences are moving greatly in that direction. And this is an important article by a man called Verma, who's a distinguished virologist, who's the editor of the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science, Impact, Not Impact Factors. How can we, in thinking about the structure of a sensible research assessment exercise system, how can we cope with these things? I'm afraid, in my view, REFs are not perfectible, you might say. Perhaps that's not very exact use of English. But we have to try to get the most fruitful system we can intellectually, you might say. How might we react to all of that? Well, my own instinct would be to try to face it squarely. We could have far fewer REFs. All we know for sure is that given enough hindsight, we can make a good job, especially mixing citation status, some other mechanical data, and peer review common sense. We can make a good stab with the benefit of hindsight to judging research. We've seen data that suggests that even pretty diligent referees in a strong journal cannot predict the difference between an article that will sink without trace, ladies and gentlemen, and I have published some articles that sank without trace, even in very famous journals and very influential ones. So I'd like to see the ref spread out over a decade, let's say, more years to allow real data to accrue rather than guessing ex ante. We could encourage our young researchers, especially, it's too old for me, largely my time is done, I'm afraid, but we could encourage our young researchers to recall there's no point in trying to make a big influence in 10 intellectual areas. It's not going to work. A handful of people have won two Nobel Prizes in history, but probably they didn't make massive contributions to the 10 areas. So we could encourage focus on quality, I suppose you might call it, less fussing about quantity. And really, that's what the world wants of us. The world doesn't care tuppence whether I publish 10 articles or 500 articles. The world's only really going to listen to one or two ideas from me. In thinking about the design of a ref, I'll stop then, and I think we're going to go forward, and we'd be delighted to take questions and discussion. I like to remember the need for tremendous humility with me as well, ladies and gentlemen, refereeing. I feel the responsibility about our abilities to judge quality and forecast eventual importance. We have seen in this country, if I'm allowed to say, a bunch of really sensible, experienced, distinguished men and women sit on ref panels, but we know they just can't do the job that hindsight would give them. It's really hard for referees, and it's really hard for ref panels even two or three or four years later. I like to bear in mind the error of thinking that journal names tell us a lot about individual article quality. It has always been true in my lifetime that we wanted, anybody wanted a paper, and let's say the American Economic Review or whatever, it's unlikely that will ever change, but there's some reason to believe that especially our younger researchers are being encouraged to lose track of why we're in this business in the first place. And third, quantity hardly matters. It's hard enough for any of us to make an impact on one thing that will ever be remembered. I think it's sensible, I'll draw to a close there, to recall that as we're economists, we know what happens, thinking about can you make a contribution, you know what happens to all of us in the long run. There it is, ladies and gentlemen. So that's part of the constraints that bear down upon the notion of an optimal ref design. Thank you very much.
So, yeah, it's a good time to ask your questions. So there is a person on the left and the person on the right. Please raise your hand. There is a person raising hand in the pink shirt over there. Please. Yeah, thank you. And there is a Ramesh. Yeah. Yep. Please give the microphone. Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you so much. I just have a question to Professor Oswald. You said, this is something I may have missed in the presentation, you said that you're inclined to recommend an interval of decades between refs. And I was inclined to think, why not more frequent refs to avoid the issue of gaming the system, or, I don't know how to say this accurately, but surprise refs, so that departments can't plan ahead and rather keep going in research up to a good standard all the time?
It's a perfectly fair question. Of course, there are pluses and minuses with all design features, and that's partly, I suppose, why we're having this session today. The idea of a very long ref period, let's say 10 years, appeals to me because it would allow us to gain more insight about what are the really important contributions. I know it's an extreme example, but let's take it back to Ronald A. Fisher. For the first 5 years after Doll's article, he would have blocked everything to do with that line of research. If he'd been the referee, of course, he would have done the same. And that would have led to millions of premature deaths. That is an extreme, but the truth is that no matter how brilliant or sensible we think we are, or even are, we just don't know within the space of a few years what will go on to be extremely influential. Of course, there are going to be errors either way, and we know that just taking citations as one metric, it's not perfect. We know from the bibliometrics literature that the early years numbers of citations are, of course, a predictor of later years. But that's just a result about the regression slope, you might say, or the means. Anyway, that's my key concern. In a world where we're hardly going to make more than one contribution as an individual, and we need to encourage that, then long lags seem sensible.
Okay. Any other comments about... So the question was more like, can we have more frequent ref? Like, if we have ref every day, would that make a big difference?
A daily ref, what a great idea. I think it's remarkable how much we agree. The three of us, we were basically saying very, very similar things, but we're economists, so let's focus on where we differ. And I don't completely agree with Andrew on this 10-year window. It's an intriguing idea. I think the problem is, and that's, you remember what I did in my numbers, I looked at the previous ref window with the wisdom of hindsight. So that is actually, what, 5 years ago, say 4 years ago. But the problem for a panel, let's take it at the moment, the plan is there will be sub-panels in 2021, and they'll be looking at papers published between 2013 and 2020. The ones that are published in 2013, they can probably form a reasonable judgment about based on citations. And I'll come back to citations being imperfect. But the ones published in 2020, you know, they're just out. Google Scholar would be a better guide because they at least will cite citations to the working papers. But Web of Science is very slow to come online. You look at some classic papers and they really took a long time to take off. So I'm not persuaded by the argument that a longer window would work because it would accentuate the difference between those that come early, papers published early in that window, and papers published less. But it's a tough problem.
Okay, Jenny?
I think with the experience of the Italian system where they have very short windows, I think longer is better. I probably think 7 is about the right time, 7, 8, 9, you know, too long, it just never happened. Somebody would slip out of the system. But you mentioned something about the surprise ref. And so one day, you know, like I don't know who is a parent, but Ofsted visits to school used to be planned 6 months or a year in advance. Now they phone the day before the visit, say we're coming for an Ofsted inspection tomorrow. And that avoids a lot of worry and hassle and things. Avoids a bit of gaming. I mean, I'm going to confess having done that, but I had the paper provisionally accepted with some changes about the mid of December, and I kept it for a month or so that it was certain to be published in the next exercise, because I already had my full quota of 4, so I wanted to make sure I had already one for the next. So it might abolish a bit of that. But I don't know how much, I don't think it would change much, personally. It's an intriguing idea, but I think the substance would not change.
Sound good? Okay. And there was Speaker Rido.
Thank you. Just wanted to raise the issue again of time and also citations. The idea that gaming only happens with citations, I think, is probably untrue. I think it happens with publications too. And I think Heckman actually made this point in his presentation at the AEA conference. I think, for me personally, new ideas, it seems to me, take a very long time to come about. And I think if you're doing something that's different, that's going against the stream, from, the lead journals, then that's going to take a lot longer to publish, and the impact is going to come maybe later as well. And I think that's the problem here, is that what people are doing, they're making little additions to papers that are in there, and so we're getting lots of clustering around areas. And I just one story that I think is a really interesting anecdote. There's a friend of ours called Henry Rozovsky, who was Dean of the Faculty of Arts and Sciences at Harvard. And he was in two different periods of time. One of the periods, John Rawls was in the philosophy department. And he tells this great story about how lots of people in the department used to come and complain to him because Rawls hadn't produced anything. And this went on for a long time. And Henry just kept saying, no, I've got confidence in this man. And the piece of work that he came out with after that was Theory of Justice. Now, I'm not saying that any of us in the room or any of us in Britain necessarily going to produce that, but if we've got something that is different, that's swimming against the stream, it needs time to come out. Having to keep publish constantly, little marginal additions that flatter the people who are editing the journals or who are citing whatever, I don't think it's going to get us really big ideas.
Okay. Any comments on that? Andrew?
I have an... I won't say anything, no. I'm implicated, as it were.
Thank you. Jenny?
Yeah, well, I agree. I think one thing that I think Peter stressed in his opening was that at which level we evaluate, and we ought not to evaluate at individual level, which is one of the worst things that the Italian system has done. So the individual output is actually not quite made public, but it's made public to the individual in question only, who then can inform the rest of his department, who is at the school. And that's very bad, because we have to look at distribution. So if Harvard believes that John Rawls is going to produce something that will make Harvard eminent and important beyond any short term, then they can take one person that is not producing, and that's fine. So that's why, you know, if we think one QJ paper is going to be excellent, that's wrong. But if a department has 10, 15 QJ papers, then it's probably a good department. Not all of them will be outstanding, but on average they will be. So I think the correct evaluation level has to be the department as opposed to the individual. And in that case, you can take the risk of hiring somebody that is early career because they will produce in the future and they might not. So I think that would be the answer I give, that because you evaluate sufficiently large groups, the intelligent person that sees beyond, and you know, the head of school at Harvard presumably is, sees beyond the short term, will take the risk, say, I believe in that person. Sometimes there will be mistakes, but it's not going to be.
Yeah, so the John Rawls story links a bit with Andrew's points, and I suppose I'm thinking about, again, distributions versus draws and extremes versus averages. I think where the most that any evaluation system can hope for is to evaluate what you might call normal science. A really big conceptual breakthrough is going to face resistance. It's going to take some time to influence people. There are examples. I mean, the best example, I guess, is the Nobel. How many actual papers basically won the Nobel Prize? The Market for Lemons. George Akerlof's famous paper is a classic, which was rejected by, did appear in the QJE, but was rejected by, was it three? Or four, two or three journals beforehand, and took some time to appear and took some time to accumulate citations. I don't think the ref process is good at identifying those kinds of papers. I don't think any evaluation process is so good. But at the end of the day, most of academia is concerned with normal science because we don't have time to wait for the abnormal stuff to be identified. There's a big fog. I liked that image, the fog of research. We're all engaged in our own little bits, and it takes time for really good ideas to win the Darwinian struggle. And in the meantime, you have to take decisions on funding, on promotions, on tenure, and so on. So, thank
you. So even the small things are taking like 9 years of publication lag in economics. I have a paper with 6 revise and resubmits in a row in the same place. I mean, not even talking about problems with the big things, even small things take a lot of time. So you're completely correct. Can you please give a microphone to the person in the second row? Thank you.
One thing I'm surprised at that hasn't been touched on by the panelists is how the nature of the game will change, particularly inside departments. Take a department of 25 people. Two times that means 50 papers to be submitted. Anything between 0 and 6 per person, depending on what happens. Okay, so 50 papers, it now becomes a tournament. We actually know about tournaments. Lazier and Rosen told us about tournaments. It means that it becomes a competitive process inside the department. So at the margin, me getting a paper in at number 50 in my department of 25 will displace a colleague, potentially a colleague who only has one paper in that list, because obviously the rational thing for the department to do is to rank every paper down to the 50th paper in a department of 25. So that's contrary to the spirit of every ref beforehand, which has been a cooperative, supportive environment. And I think that worries me, because if you change the dynamic in departments to one of competition and tournaments, rather than cooperative endeavor, scholarship, co-authorship, I'm worried about that. And I'd be interested in the panelists' comments.
Who wants to start?
That is one of the points I was making, that, you know, it's like, you know, if you give a football team very high prizes for scoring goals, then I'm not going to make that assist that will give my, you know, I'll try to score myself, and that's not good. So cooperation in the department, you know, at the moment we have that one cut-off decision in or out, but when we start having 6-7 different categories of people, those with 6, those with 5, those with 4, those with 3, those with 2, that will create tension and will create a nightmare for whoever's going to decide. So, and that, I agree that that would be a very controversial and counterproductive decision to make. I can see the benefit, because you're not supposed to, you know, evaluating the department is the right thing to do, so you should have, you should allow for people to take a year off or to you know, okay, take 4 years, work on the big idea. We have faith on you, so we don't submit you. We submit you with zero input because we know you work John Rawls. But there are side effects of that, which are probably, yeah.
So we are out of time. Let's do one final question from over there and close the official part on that, because coffee is not going to drink itself.
Could I perhaps reinforce some of the points that have been made? You know, the point about lags. I was thinking perhaps an even better example of lags is that I think two of the most important papers that have ever been written in economics were Ramsey's two papers, one on economic growth and one on taxation. They were published in 1927 and 1928. Now, I haven't looked at the citation count for those papers in the 30 years after they were published. My guess is that they would be very low indeed. So, it may, you know, the point is that it may take a very long time. You know, how long did it take with the Ramsey papers? 50, 60, 70 years. So, lags may be very, very long indeed. But more generally, can I ask whether anybody really would like to defend citations as an important part of the assessment process? Because there's so many things wrong with using citations as an index of research quality. There's the lags. Another example is Harvelmo, who won the Nobel Prize. People looked up his citation count, and they could find hardly any citations. But the reason was that his contributions had been absorbed into the literature. So the contributions were there, but they weren't. It didn't contribute to his citation count. And also, bad papers can be cited. I think David Hendry has an example of a paper in another discipline that is cited widely, but the reason why it's cited is that it's cited as an example of how not to tackle a particular problem. I'm sure there are quite a lot of examples of this. So, do you think that citations really are an important part of the research assessment process? That's one thing. Perhaps slightly facetiously, can I suggest another metric to use? Walking up to the university, I saw a sign saying that Bristol University had 11 of its former graduates and members of staff had won Nobel Prizes. That was interesting to me, because University of Birmingham has exactly the same figure, 11 people. So why not use that? Number of members of staff or graduates who have won the Nobel Prize. Slightly facetious, but only slightly facetious.
So for Ramsey, it's 3,000 for 1927 and 6,000 for 1928 paper. Who wants to reply to the suggestions? Peter?
I'll ignore the facetious bit. On citations, yeah. I would say, I mean, Havelmo and Ramsey, perfect examples. The fact remains they were writing at a time when economics as a profession was not as professionalized as it is now, and it wasn't possible to go on the web and check out citations and so on. So should citations be used at all? The it's in the public domain. The economics subpanel was the only one in main panel C, in the social sciences broadly defined, which used citations, and we argued that we wanted to have access to them, but we would not treat them as gospel and so on. Again, this comes back to computers versus humans. Even to evaluate metrics, to evaluate citations, you do need to have professionals who understand the culture and understand exactly the kinds of issues that you've raised and the ones that were mentioned. To say that they're of no value at all, they were, I think it's fair to say, and this is also in the public domain, in the report of the main panel C, they were used by the economics panel, but in very few cases did they actually make a difference to evaluating even a single paper. So I think it's useful background in a check when you're a bit worried about your field or a topic you're not quite familiar with, you're not sure about the paper, but if lots of people have cited it, perhaps the chances are that it's better than worse. It's still a gamble and still very hard to predict in the long term.
Thank you very much. We are really run out of time. Thank you for coming. Let's thank the speakers for their notices.